I'm Tony, he's Mike, and today we are talking about 1983 science fiction, fantasy, everything but the kitchen sink, Krull.
On a distant planet, a great kingdom was ravaged by beings who came from the future to conquer the universe. Only survivors follow a doubtful seer and a throneless king.
They will hold her in the Black Fortress. You must have help.
Thieves, bandits, fighters, and brawlers.
Desperate men. Those are the kind of men I need.
At the end of an impossible journey, they must fight an invincible enemy.
She'll be your king.
In the fortress, you will face more than the slayers.
Columbia Pictures presents A World Apart from Anything You Have Seen Before. Krull.
And we wanted to talk about this before. J.J. Abrams ruins another part of our childhood.
What?
Yes, yes. He actually announced a few weeks back that he is actually working on a remake of Krull, so we can... Another one bites the dust.
And another one gone, and another one gone. Another one bites the dust, yeah.
He's running out of properties to ruin. He's already screwed up Star Wars. He's already screwed up Star Trek. So now he's got to move on to, you know, this. And I don't know, maybe we'll get lucky and get J.J. Abrams' RoboCop.
Or I had a shitty remake of RoboCop.
Yes, but it wasn't shitty enough.
No, I guess not. That's terrible. I'm sad to hear that.
I was fucking angry when I heard it. That's all there is to it. Like, legitimately, I was like, a Krull remake in the works. And I was like, ooh, ooh.
Oh, That does sound good.
And then I was like, J.J. Abrams. And I was like, ooh.
Motherfucker.
Ooh. Yeah. Yeah, I think that's the appropriate reaction to this.
Well, let's talk about the good. Let's talk about this film, directed by Peter Yates, who also did your movie that we just reviewed.
Yeah. Which one was it? It was Breaking Away.
It's Breaking Away.
But
yes.
He also did, was it 3 Days of the Condor?
No, he didn't do that one. But he also did Steve McQueen's Bullet too.
Oh, well, there
you
go.
So, I mean, I didn't realize the many different genres this guy has done directing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
You know, and he's had a hit in every single genre so far, including this one. As flawed as it is,
yeah,
it's still pretty darn fun.
It is fun. I was going to say, this was his first foray into science fiction, and he wound up like taking this job because he thought it sounded like it would be interesting, but it turned out that it was an incredibly frustrating experience for him, mm-hmm. So much so that he left in the middle of production for 3 weeks to go on a Caribbean vacation, and then he came back and finished it. And I think that explains a lot of the problems with this film, and let's get to brass tacks. This film is a flawed masterpiece. It has such beautiful production design. It looks like nothing else. It is most definitely derivative of Star Wars and a few other, but it doesn't look like a Star Wars film.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I don't think it's very derivative. I mean, the only thing that really makes it Star Wars is the fact that you got like a evil villain from outer space, you know, coming to invade.
Yeah.
But other than that, to me, it's more of your straight up, D&D plot, you know, somebody kidnapped the princess, you gotta go find her. It's like Legend of Zelda before Legend of Zelda came out,
the
or
super
or whatever.
Hot princess,
right? So anyways, just to quickly go through the plot, you know, the Black Fortress comes and lands on the planet Krull. Slayers have been popping up all over the planet, taking over kingdoms. It seems like the only one left.
There's two ancient kingdoms, yes, that have been warring forever, mm-hmm. And they have decided that the two children, the handsome young man and the hot young lady, have decided that they're going to unite the kingdom as one so that they can fight back against the evil that has come to their world. And
yeah, so it's Alyssa and Colwyn,
yeah,
and you open up with Alyssa and her dad,
mm-hmm.
And he's like very much against this thing, even though he knows eventually they're going to get invaded and conquered. And she's like, no, stupid.
Yeah.
Let's join kingdoms so you got a fighting chance. Yeah. You know, put your petty BS aside.
Warriors make bad husbands.
But I see no reason for an alliance with our ancient enemies.
Father, the invaders are destroying our world. We only if we're united do we stand a chance against them. The marriage is my choice.
If it were anyone but Turl's son.
Corwin is a great fighter.
Good fighters make bad husbands.
That's the phrase that's used on that one. So he's really trying to dissuade her from getting married at all. But they do wind up starting the ceremony, and they're interrupted by a horde of slayers. And I'm going to say this. That first fight sequence is stunning.
I give fire to water. It will not return, except from the hand of the woman I choose as my wife.
I take fire from water. I give it only to the man whom I choose as my husband.
It is absolutely gorgeous. It is beautifully shot. It's shot at night, and it's the slayers, they're all, you know, dark armored characters, and in the hands of a lesser cinematographer or a lesser, you know, somebody behind the camera, it would have just been a dark muddled mess. It's gorgeous. You can see everything that's going on. The action is smooth. It's fun. It's riveting. It's completely a swashbuckler from the 40s.
Yes, it is.
Absolutely. Yes. It's swinging from the curtains and the sword fighting and all that. Yeah. I love that whole first fight sequence. I really do. Just dig everything about it. Colwyn is wounded. Lyssa gets ridden off by the slayers. Yeah, sorry. I keep wanting to call them Black Riders, but I know that that's not right. But Colwyn wakes up to an old man touching him inappropriately with his shirt already off.
Then, show us on the doll where the bad man touched you. It's not bad. I'll even show it here.
Lyssa!
She's alive.
Where?
Stay still.
Where?
For now, beyond your reach.
And then after he wakes up and he's like, oh, where's my hottie at? And then he's all like, she's been kidnapped. We got to go rescue her. And shenanigans ensue. I mean, that's really the best way that I can explain it. And naturally, everything has a happy ending. Because at the end of the day, it's a fairy tale and it should have a happy ending.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm going to talk about the good things here first. Yeah. It is a pretty good blend of, you know, semi-sci-fi and you know, your medieval stuff in there.
Absolutely.
The slayers and the beasts, all that stuff look appropriately otherworldly, but at the same time, like, seem appropriate for that kind of universe.
If
that makes any sense, because like the guards for the castle, you know, they have a kind of like a high-tech armor look to them.
The only bad
thing about those is that Both look like they're made of rubber and plastic. They both look kind of cheap. Where compared to like Star Wars, those uniforms and costumes and armor look practical and something that they actually, a bit more lived in.
A bit less design conscious, a bit more practicality.
I agree with you.
Like
you can
that
see
one.
Those people using that stuff every day. Here in Krull, like you could tell this is very like 60s, 70s sci-fi. Oh. You know, or sci-fi from another new generation.
Yeah. I don't disagree with anything on that, but I will also say this, because it is a science fantasy film, they kind of get a pass from me because it all just looks so damn cool. And I mean, that's it in a nutshell. If you're doing a science fiction film and your science fiction-y stuff doesn't look cool, who cares? It's got to look cool in one regard or another. It can't just be like, you know, Plan 9 from Outer Space with some silver paper plate set on fire. You got to do the work on that one.
The other thing I like about this, too, is you got a good group of adventurers. Like I said earlier, this is like straight out of like D&D. You know, you got your fighter.
And you lead this army with mine against the Slayers?
Whatever army I have, I'll lead against them. Until I've won, or I'm dead.
You got your, you know, former warrior, great warriors, come back out of retirement for like one last romp, yeah. You know.
I am Ynir.
The old one.
Well, not as old as all that.
You got your wizard.
I am Ergo the Magnificent. Short in stature, tall in power, narrow of purpose, and wide of vision.
You got your token, non-piece, you know, non-human character in there.
Yeah.
His name is Rel. He visits the seer sometimes. He doesn't speak much.
So I've noticed.
Or jest with those who already are his friends.
The Cyclops, and then you got your general band of thieves and fighters and, you
know. Ne'er-do-wells.
Yeah.
You're escaped prisoners.
Everyone.
Thieves, bandits, fighters, and brawlers.
Yeah, exactly.
But, you know, they're rip-rousing and ready to go. And I'm going to say this. This movie works its ass off for the first 35 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And then Ergo the Magnificent shows up. And like, from the moment he opens his mouth, I hate him. I hate everything about him. I like it. Like, there's nothing that comes out of his mouth that doesn't make me want to slap the shit out of him.
Help! I'm drowning! This might have been quicksand! I might have been sucked to my death while you stood there gulping!
And it's like, I realize that he's like supposed to be this big bravado. Oh, hey, I'm a wizard, mind you. You know, blah, 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 blah. But he's played so ineptly. And I don't know if it was a directing choice or if they didn't want to like stray too far off a formula or whatever. But like, that character just gets under my skin in a way that it's just one of those, oh man, why you show up to ruin my movie?
I understand where you're coming from, and I agree, he is definitely the most annoying person in this movie by far.
Yes.
Hands down, no argument there.
Yeah.
But I get where the direction is coming from.
Because
you gotta have some type of, you know, comedic relief and things like that. And that's kind of what he's there for. Is it executed the greatest?
The hill people lack the power to do harm.
We shall see about that, old man. We'll see about that. No, that's a recipe for hot fudge sauce. Oh, well, it'll have to be a goose. Fat and ugly.
Very fat, very ugly.
No. It's not, but it's passable enough. It didn't ruin the movie for me or make it any less enjoyable. Because I kind of like the bit of buffoonery and his bravado, and then the Cyclops gives that classic line. Go ahead, give it.
But small people need large names to give them weight.
Your actions give you weight, my friend.
I'm not even going to say that his dialogue is bad. I'm going to say his delivery of it is bad, because comedically, none of it lands. Like literally, there's not a well-told joke by him. In this entire role. Now, there is a heartwarming.
There's nothing that says that it's a joke. It's all the circumstances, you know, because it's buffoonery and stuff like that. Because he is an inept wizard.
Yeah.
And, but he comes through in the clutch in the end.
He does, but I'm going to say this. All the other performances are so strong in this. Even the bit characters, even Titch, you know, the little kid.
I am Ergo the Magnificent. Short in stature, tall in power, narrow of purpose, and wide of vision.
That is very impressive.
I should hope so.
I'm Titch.
That's not impressive, but adequate. Mm-hmm.
You know, is a really well-realized character, the Emerald Wizard.
We seek the Black Fortress.
Such a vision will be opposed. Who seeks it?
The new king.
With an old voice.
You know the voice.
Yes, my friend.
The Widow of the Web.
Nyssa.
I was young when I last heard that name. You had a son. We had a son.
But
you said nothing.
I killed him when he was born. And this is my punishment.
All of them are like just a few minutes of film and they're all realized and performed really well. So his performance really sticks out as the sore thumb.
It does.
In this movie.
Yeah.
The other issue with this film, and again, this comes from a place of love. The other issue with this film is that it gets wrapped up in too many f***ing side quests.
Yes, there's quite a few side quests.
First, we've got to go get the glaive. Okay, great, got the glaive. All right, now what are we doing? Well, we got to go see the Emerald Seer because he's going to let us know where the fortress is. Oh, no, we're stuck in the quicksand. And by the way, movies like this are the reason that I thought quicksand would be a far bigger problem as an adult than it has been. But, the Emerald Seer gets trapped and blah, blah, blah. And says, oh, no, now we got to go see the Widow of the Web. And then they go and see the Widow of the Web. And then they're like, oh, well, you know, now we know that it's going to be in the Iron Desert. So what do we do? Well, now we got to go find some fire mares. And then we've got to ride. And it's like, get to it, you know? Yeah. I mean.
How long is this movie? It's right at 2 hours, ain't it?
It's under 2 hours. It's like an hour and 50 minutes. Like
It's essentially two damn hours.
Yeah. Okay. But. You know, it's just there needed to be a little bit more meat in the script. And this is a funny story too. I did some reading up on this one in preparation for this review, is that apparently it was originally titled The Dragons of Krull, and there was a script that was written, and they're like, okay, we like the idea, we're gonna start production on this, and we're gonna, you know, rewrite the script as we go. And they gave it to another script writer, and he rewrote the script and he turned it in, and they're like, there's too many words in this. So they just went back to the first draft of the script and they decided that they were gonna polish it as they went. And that's readily apparent in this.
I didn't really have any problem with the story. The story is simple enough, it's effective enough, and the runtime, you know, it didn't seem to really drag on any longer for me than it needed to. It was perfectly fine. I was engaged enough. The thing that I don't really enjoy too much about is the fact that it looks the way it looks compared to Star Wars.
Yeah.
Because it's just a fact of life. Since 1977, you're going to compare everything to Star Wars.
Yeah.
Is what it is. So it's hard for me to look past the hokey costumes and kind of the overall hokey sets and things like that there, because it looks very much like they're on a set.
Oh, absolutely.
And
absolutely.
You know, not in a real environment or something like that. So it's like, it's tough for movies. You got up your game because you got this new standard you got to hit. And so it's, you know, that for me is what, you know, knocks points off of this movie. But even then, it's still a fun movie. It's still a recommend for me.
Yeah, it's absolutely a recommend for me. For no other reason than just a nostalgia trip on this one. But I was going to say, the whole quicksand sequence could completely be cut out. There's nothing going. They lose one guy. Then when the seer gets killed, and then they realize that it's one of the doppelgangers that has taken his place, and they stab him, and you see his face like all bulbous and out and getting all weird and black and pussy. That is some straight up nightmare fuel.
Here is the knowledge you seek.
And the makeup effects on that is absolutely great. I love when they kill a slayer, the little serpent thing that pops out of the top of their head and climbs into the ground. That is like the shit that sticks with me on this one.
I was wrong. Actually, a couple other things I don't like about this movie. Number one is the beast at the end. That battle at the end is so boring and so fucking lame. Like the glaive is supposed to be a super powerful thing, and it is, but just so hokey in camera and being used. Because you know, what's his name? He's out there, like, you know, using the force to move the glaive and all this stuff. And then, you know, ends up getting stuck in the beast. So that's not even the weapon that kills him in the end. Spoilers. What kills him in the end is love. It's love. And the fire from the love.
Melissa, it's us. It's us he can't defeat.
Take the fire from my hand.
power thing the whole time. You didn't need this weapon. It's like using a Schwartz. It's, you know?
It's the red herring of that. And there's multiple red herrings in here. Yeah. I'm going to say this. There is a space for somebody to remake this. There is the potential for an absolute great film in this concept.
Yeah. Just not done by J.J. Abrams.
Yeah. Yeah. That too. But I'm also going to say
first and foremost.
Yeah. They needed a director. You know, I'd like to see Guillermo del Toro take a shot at this. Cause
see, I'm not a fan of his. There's some things I enjoy by him. Like, don't get me wrong. I like his take on Hellboy is good. Mm-hmm. But other than that,
he's hit and miss for me. I'm not crazy about Pacific Rim, but I do like Pan's Labyrinth quite a bit. I think that his take on fantasy characters specifically, I find really interesting. I'm trying to think. There's a few others that I would throw out there. Mm-hmm. Don't give this to a headliner, and definitely don't give it to Abrams. Give it to somebody who's got a few films under their belt and has shown that they know their way around science fiction mm-hmm. and science fantasy and can handle, you know, that kind of thing. But this flaw with this film is that it was a first-time director and that they didn't have a finished concept when they started
shooting. No, it's not first-time director, Peter.
No, I mean first-time fantasy film director, because he'd never done anything like this before. And again, it shows. But the soundtrack is great.
Yes, the score is really good. It's properly epic.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's not derivative or anything like that. It's just,
James Horner, and if you listen to this soundtrack, this is not casting stones. This is just saying if you're familiar with his work, you can listen to Star Trek II, and there are several beats in the music that you'll be I know that one.
Yeah, but you can say that about any composer.
True. I mean,
you listen like an Alan Silvestri, soundtrack from film to film. Yeah, there's cues and stuff like that. Yeah. It's the same thing with any composer, any band, anything. I mean, you can trace the lineage.
They have a specific audioscape that's signature.
Do you recommend it?
I would absolutely recommend it. I would recommend it, but don't expect it to be a perfect film. Expect there to be flaws and expect them to be obvious. But that doesn't make it unenjoyable. It just means be patient with it.
Would you buy it? Would you recommend buying it?
I
know you own it.
I would. No, I don't. Actually.
I really don't.
I do not actually own this one. And after rewatching, I'm thinking this is a movie that's perfect for cable. It is one of those when it's on, you'll be like, oh yeah, Krull, and then you sit down and you're watching and you go, it's not quite as good as I remember it being. It's not bad, but it's not as good as I remember it being. But
I'm really shocked by that. I thought for sure you would own this because this is definitely your. It seemed like your slice of film.
It is absolutely, it falls in my wheelhouse, but it falls just outside of I have to own this kind of movie thing. So,
well, I'm going to say this. You should buy it, if nothing else, before it gets buried by J.J. Abrams. That's the only thing you can find or rent anymore without hitting high seas.
That
so.
Will most definitely be the reason why I buy this on Blu-ray. Yeah.
But even beyond that, it's a fun adventure film, so it's a recommend for me. So. Okay.
There you have it. There you are. That's, anything else?
No.
No.
We will see you guys the next time.
Another one gone, another one gone, another one bites the dust, yeah.